It's time for Windows Weekly. Paul Thurrott and Mary Jo Foley are here coming up. We're going to talk about why many people still haven't received the anniversary update. Is it the end of the line for Microsoft's fitness band? And Mary Jo Foley has a dream about a new Windows device called the Cardinal. Whatever could it be? We'll find out next on Windows Weekly.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT.
Bandwidth for Windows Weekly is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This is Windows Weekly with Paul Thurrott and Mary Jo Foley, episode 483, recorded Wednesday, September 14th, 2016. The Crumb in the Corner. Windows Weekly is brought to you by IT Pro TV. IT Pro TV is an easy, entertaining approach to online IT training. For a free 7-day trial and 30% off the life of your account, go to itpro.tv/ww and use the code WW30. And by Carbonite. Keep your business safe this year. Protect files on your computer or server with automatic cloud backup from Carbonite. Try it free. No credit card needed at Carbonite.com today. Use the offer code Windows to get 2 free bonus months if you decide to buy. And by the Ring Video Doorbell. With Ring, you can see and talk to anyone at your door from anywhere in the world using your smartphone. It's like caller ID for your house. Go to ring.com/ww and get up to $150 off a Ring of Security kit with their limited time offer. It's time for Windows Weekly, the show where we talk about the latest Windows news. All the news that's fit to print. Well, we don't print it anymore, but it would fit. All the news is fit to, I don't know, stream?
Blog.
Blog. That's Mary Jo Foley, allaboutmicrosoft.com. That's the name of her ZDNet blog. And they don't say you got to do 21 inches today?
No.
No. That would be foolish.
Those days are gone. Thank
God.
Goodness.
Yeah.
They're measured in feet now, Leo.
Paul Thurrott, Thurrott.com, where he publishes 16 feet of wisdom every single day.
One metric ton.
It's like wisdom by the foot. And today we are gathered together to talk once again about Microsoft. Wait, before we go, though, this is my last day before I go on vacation. And then when I come back, you got like Ignite. Or am I not going to be here for that? I think I'm not. Maybe
you're
not going to be here.
Not going to be here for that.
Oh, nuts. When's the Ignite?
We get Padre, right?
Yeah. Yeah, I know you like Padre. And so
we do like him.
That's going to be soon then.
Yeah, September 28th.
For a priest.
2 weeks. For a priest. Don't say that.
He's okay for an enterprise. He's okay for an enterprise
that's
guy.
That's better.
Is what you
that's more
say.
Appropriate. Yeah.
Priest, that's what I meant.
A priest of big iron.
Yep.
Yeah, he works with the biggest iron of them all.
Yes, he does.
And then you got to go to Amsterdam. You guys are just going crazy. Traveling.
Yep.
On the road pretty soon.
Yeah. So we had fun last week with your predictions. And somebody, I thought, quite aptly said that as long as Paul and Leo shut up, Mary Jo really is right on.
Wow. So I'll look for the constructive part of that criticism. And
look in vain,
my friend.
It wasn't
me who said that. It was not me who said that.
No, but I liked it. I thought that was a good tweet. Now, we go back and forth over whether Microsoft's going to have a hardware event. You've said in the past they are, and then I saw stuff that said no. So what's the latest is they are?
Latest we're hearing is they are, yes.
And it'll be
Surface. And last week we said maybe.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, so we think it's going to be in late October, probably the last week of October, in New York City, and that it'll be both a Microsoft hardware event and a celebration of all the partner stuff that they're championing now.
Is it going to be a worldwide partners conference kind of thing?
No, more like Microsoft Device Day type of thing. But, because they don't have a lot of their own devices coming out this holiday, they're going to be pushing a lot of the partner devices instead.
Not a Surface phone?
No. I've seen so many headlines this week saying, yep, October hardware event, Surface phone. Not what we're hearing, guys.
Surface Pro 5?
I think not yet.
New Surface Book?
I think next year also for
so that. So that would explain the confusion, which is that this is a partner event, really. It's not going to be a Microsoft new hardware.
How about a Surface mouse pad? How does that grab you? Or
a loop. I'd take a loop at this point. Give me a pen loop.
Well, the one mystery thing that we actually don't know a whole lot about what it is that I'm hearing could be at this event is something called Cardinal, Surface Cardinal.
Right.
And at first when I heard about this from my sources, I thought Cardinal might be a code name, but now I'm hearing this week it may be the brand name.
What?
Of whatever this is.
Cardinal?
Wait, what? Oh, that's a terrible name.
Oh,
I know.
My
I just heard.
God.
So, okay.
No offense to Arizona Cardinals fans, but that's a terrible name.
No, but think about this. There are a lot of laptops and other devices that have kind of meaningless brand names, like HP Spectre. Like, what does that mean?
Like every single thing that HP makes. Yeah. Dell, too.
So, same thing. Yeah. So maybe this is the brand name. And if it is, I'm curious why they are using Cardinal, like what the significance is, if there is any. I actually had a dream about this.
Oh, that's bad, Mary Jo.
I know. I'm
some vacation there. Like. You don't mind me saying so.
My crazy dream.
Yes.
You want to hear how crazy this was? Yes. And I actually woke up and thought it was real, which makes it even funnier. So I'm like, cardinal. And I'm like, you know the shape of a cardinal's head? You know how it's like sloped?
Yeah.
I'm not kidding. This was my dream. And I woke up and I'm like, this is a sign. It's something that's going to have a sloped surface. So maybe it's like an all-in-one device surface is amazing. Like on a slope. I really thought this. I'm not.
You ever see the movie Apocalypse Now, Mary Jo?
Thor.
Yeah, look. See that cardinal's head right there?
See how it's sloped?
It is an angry bird.
Yeah.
Angry bird.
Maybe they're just going to do an angry bird. Interesting.
No, so the clue that one of my sources gave me about this device is the person said, it will turn your desk into a studio. So what does that mean?
Turn your desk into a studio. God. Studio how? You know,
I don't know. My thinking there was, you know, Microsoft's been really pitching Surface at creatives quite a bit and talking about how, you know, people who are artists and people who are musicians and all these people are using Surface Book. I'm like, maybe this is an all-in-one iMac type device that actually, maybe the Surface is your desk. Just a guess. No. Pure guess. Okay. Guessing.
Like a.
I don't know. I don't know anything
not,
beyond.
Not a living room device. Hopefully not some gigantic detachable screen thing, which I think we're all a little nervous about.
I know. Right. Yeah.
Do you think, though, it would be something, the Pixel Perfect kind of acquisition?
Yeah.
I do. I think, you know, so when they bought Perceptive Pixel, they bought a company that made these giant multi-touch devices, and now they're selling those in the form of Surface Hub. But what if you could take that screen and somehow make it your desk? Or somehow make it your all-in-one type screen on your desk, like, you know, like an iMac.
What about those, the Shepard Fairey, was it Shepard Fairey? No, Shepard, the guy on Fox News, Shepard, whatever his name was. Shepard Fairey's an artist. Shepard Pie, yeah. Remember, they were all sitting at what looked like they were little tiny people at giant iPads, but in fact, they were Surface Hubs. Maybe they make that. Like they tilt them and make it like an easel.
The
and
thing, okay, but even
for finger painting.
What is it? 55-inch Surface Hub costs.
Yeah, it's ridiculous.
A lot of money.
Something it's a lot of money. $5,000.
Shepard Smith. That's the one. Shepard Smith.
But Windows Central had a story a couple months back where they were predicting there'd be a Surface all-in-one, and they even said, we believe Microsoft's testing three sizes, 21-inch, 24-inch, or 27-inch. So it would be smaller than the Hub. And if those numbers are right and if they are testing those devices, that could be the thing for your desk, right?
Let's go in the complete opposite direction since we're speculating. Okay. What if it's just screens? You know, what if this is something about docking Surface devices that already exist or maybe coming down the line and turning them into a more suitable desktop replacement than is possible with the current solution, yep. right? Because one of the big issues that I have with Surface, and I think a lot of people do, is when you dock it to a desktop display, it doesn't have the same dot pitch. It doesn't have the same mm-hmm. aspect ratio. And unless you use both screens at the same time, you get into some weird areas there. It'd be kind of neat if you could just dock a Surface Book and have it be a big version of the same display.
Yeah, that would be cool. And fit in with Continuum, right? Like the whole push for Continuum. Yeah.
I think that'd be great, personally. In fact, I've been kind of calling on them to make a 3x2 Surface display. But
intriguing.
That would be cool, right? Like, say you had a Surface Pro or a Surface Book, and this is just a monitor that you somehow plug
same
into
aspect
the dock.
Ratio, right? Same resolution, just bigger screen.
Awesome.
I mean, it's Surface, right? So they would want it to be multi-touch, and you could, you know, bring it down and write on it and stuff. And that's fine. Right. I mean, all that stuff is fine.
Yeah.
But I'd love to have a bigger screen Surface display, essentially.
That'd be pretty cool. And if it's multi-touch, you could use multiple pens if you're an artist, or you could do a lot of different things with that Surface if you're somebody who uses touch or inking. Like, there's a lot of different kind of possibilities where you could talk about studio, artist studio, musician studio. I think it all fits in somehow.
The word studio is a lot better word for this product than cardinal.
Yeah. And, you know, so I also will say, like, this is just based on source reports. It's possible they could change this. I've never seen them brand or trademark the word cardinal.
How much of this comes from a fever dream that you had?
The word cardinal did not. But my crazy idea about the slope of it is a dream. And, you know, I got to stop drinking so much craft beer right before bed. That's all I'm going to say. Sure. I'm blaming the beer.
This is what you get for drinking IPAs, Mary Jo.
See, it's all those crazy hops that are making me have hop dreams. So we don't know much. The rumored date that one of my sources said could be the date for this event is September 28th, which is a Wednesday, which is also the day Paul and I will be at at Ignite. Sorry, not September 20th. October 26th. Sorry.
That's when you'll be totally in Amsterdam.
We'll be in Las Vegas. Leo, I'm surprised you can't keep track of our schedule.
I can't keep track of, like, my weekly schedule.
So you might have to miss if there's an event, you might have to miss it. Because you're committed to Vegas. You can't just say, we're not going.
No, and you know, there's
a cold coming on, though.
I think they'll stream. If this does happen when we're thinking it might happen, I'm sure they'll stream it.
Right.
And, you know, there'll be a lot of opportunities.
You have my commitment. We'll cover it. Yeah. And, you know, it's Wednesday. Yeah. So what we could do is... because you're probably committed to a particular time on Wednesday as well for your broadcast.
There might be some flexibility in that.
Okay. So let the organizers know that if Microsoft does an event in the morning that we might cover the stream, you don't need to be there for that if you don't want to. You could, of course. And then we'll do the show right after, which means we'd
back a little bit. Wanting to cover that live. I mean, in some ways, that would make up for not
being
there.
That could be the show.
Yeah.
It could be the show.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
All right. Well,
again, we don't know that that's a date. There's been no invitation sent out. That's just based on sources. And Microsoft obviously is not commenting or confirming.
And Microsoft, if you could swing it, the first week of November would be way better.
Way better. I think there might be something going. I feel like there's something going on the first week of November.
Is there? Oh, man.
Oh, a presidential election. That's right.
Oh, well, thing. Sorry. Oh,
that might. How about the third week of October? Right. How could I forget that?
Oh, yeah. Whoops. Something. I don't know what. Something's happening.
Yeah.
Is it November 8th? Another weird voting? I can't remember.
Another weird thing about this whole, like, Microsoft fall hardware launch, I don't know if Paul remembers this, but I don't ever remember them giving the day, the actual event day, a code name before. But this day, this device day thing, has a code name, and it's Project Rio, or IO.
Her name is Rio, and she sailed the Rio. Yeah, November 8th, we're voting. If they could do it the week before, November 2nd, or first.
I'd vote for that.
Sadly, I'm sure they have space already booked here, if it is here in New York.
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing. And I'm sure part of the deal is, getting that space and early certain dates and so forth.
Yeah. All right.
Sure.
All right. Oh, well.
I mean, so I already know they're hacking into my calendar. The least they could do is work around it.
Exactly.
Could you be talking about this? The peepo? God, I hope not. I don't know. MyWindowsHub.com. I don't know what it is. It's got a big antenna. Really a way too big antenna. Unless that's a gear stick. It's got a tablet on it. This looks like some sort of tablet mount.
What this looks like is one of those in-store point-of-sale things almost, right?
It might be a point-of-sale, yeah. I have no idea. I just found it in my collection somewhere. No, it said the chat room was sent this along. Where did you find this chat room and why?
I know. Why is it coming up?
Windows people.
That's funny.
Oh, by the way, as Jenny Kai just reminded me, first week of November is the MVP summit for Microsoft, so... That's not a good date for a hardware launch, probably.
Okay, Peepo is a company in China that makes Windows devices, so that's just an oddball Windows device.
It's rather odd that none of us have heard of it, but
okay. They're big in China.
Yeah, sure.
It actually costs $160. It's an actual computer, according to the Peepo store.
It's an all-in-one, like the old Commodores used to be, or the Apple II.
It's a dual-boot mini PC with 2 gigs, 32 gigs, 8.9. It's a tablet is what it is.
Oh, and it also dual-boots with Android.
Which makes it super
really
useful.
Weird. Yeah.
Because it's not portable, obviously. But it's only $120. Yeah. You know, I might buy a Peepo.
It looks like, one of those old business phones that sat on your desk back in the day.
They're calling it an airstrike.
Yeah, what's the antenna, though? It's so weird.
That's awesome.
Yeah. I guess it's phone? Got Wi-Fi, Bluetooth.
Yeah, really good Wi-Fi.
Android 4.4. Oh, this is some junk thing. Junky.
Mm-hmm.
Huh.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, this is a fairly low-end device.
You don't want it. Yeah. Trust me. But it's kind of cool looking. What if Microsoft made one that wasn't?
I don't know if this came out by the time we talked about it on the show, but remember I did that Woku thing?
Yeah.
It was a China-based PC that was housed in a little Roku-style container.
Yeah.
Sometime into my using that, about 2 weeks in, I got a licensing issue pop-up thing, and they were using some known key generator to activate Windows.
Without buying it.
Oh, yikes.
Yeah. So I contacted Amazon and I was like, I'd like to return this now, please. Oh, and by the way,
it's pirated software.
Yikes.
Yep. Got to be careful with that stuff.
Mm.
So weird.
It's so weird.
What's wrong? What's with the Chinese, Leo?
Yeah. Yeah. What is that? What's that all about? Okay. Okay, yeah. It's good speculation, though. I'm enjoying it. I like the speculation. Speaking of speculation, I saw an article this morning that said Microsoft might be killing the band, might be getting out of the band business. They're going to, the band's, they're breaking up the band.
They're going to break up the band?
Yep.
They're breaking up the band.
Is that true?
So.
Yes.
We don't know 100% for sure, but signs are looking like this could be the end of the band.
Signs point to. Yes.
Yeah. So it's funny. Both Brad Sams and I were working on this story without knowing that each other was working on it in parallel. And so they gave us both an official statement yesterday at the same time, which didn't really say a whole lot. Microsoft said, yeah, we're continuing to work on the health platform, which is the service and the software behind the band that lets you monitor sleep and your activities. And we're going to make sure that works across devices like Windows, iOS, and Android. And we're still selling Band 2. And we remain deeply committed to wearables. That's all. That's the end. So it doesn't say we're not doing a Band 3. But my sources told me no Band of any kind the rest of this calendar year, and unlikely that we'll see one anytime soon, although I couldn't get them to quite close the door all the way. They said there was a plan to try to bring Windows 10 to the next band, the band 3, and it didn't work. So they disbanded, no pun intended, that team. The software team got disbanded. Did the hardware team get disbanded? I'm not 100% sure, but I'm thinking maybe.
That's interesting. I mean, Brad has a source that told him there was still more wearables coming from Microsoft, but
I've been hearing that
we're not going to be another band, right?
Yeah.
And I don't have any firsthand information about this. I mean, Band is, and Microsoft Health, right, which is the service that kind of sits at the back end of this, are frustratingly perfect Microsoft for the modern era. Like they were first getting a lot of things out there. They're one of the first device makers to put out a wearable that was just, you know, bristling with sensors. They had GPS in this thing 2 years before Apple did it in the Apple Watch. Not that they were first, but GPS. Really capable device. I sort of feel like Microsoft's brand in the consumer space is not great, and that, of course, they didn't do a really good job or even try to market this thing in any way, shape, or form, right? The first device was almost an experiment. They only sold it at their own stores at first. Very limited availability. Mm-hmm. Lots of reliability problems. The second version was beautiful looking, kind of solved that issue. It was a much nicer looking piece of equipment. And then over time, what you realize is actually they have the same reliability issues.
I know. And the skins on those things, right?
Yeah.
They kept ripping.
They've been on fire. Yeah. Yep. So, they've been dumping them all year. And it's sad because it's a device that I think very early on, and I mean like 2 years ago, hit at a really nice sweet spot between a very complex smartwatch and a very simple and inexpensive, mm-hmm. you know, fitness device. I think they hit the right balance, but it's almost like consumers they see Microsoft and they just don't focus. You know, they keep moving on.
I think you're right. They didn't advertise this a whole lot. Like a lot of times people would see you wear it. I had one as a loner a couple times and people were like, what is that? You know, like they had never seen it. Yeah. They'd never heard of it. I'm like, the Microsoft Band, what is that? I've never even heard of that, you know?
My wife still wears one and got that twice over this past weekend. Yeah.
And yet it's a great product. I mean, it's so sad when you got this company that can make great stuff, but somehow.
Well, by the way, I mean, we won't remember all of the examples, but Media Center and Zune, and we can kind of count down.
Of them.
Yeah.
And it's Windows Phone. You know,
Connect.
It's a little depressing. Connect, maybe. Yeah. Maybe Connect. I don't know. But
maybe.
It's
Kin. How about Kin?
You know what? Kin is falls into an interesting category because it wasn't as bad as people think it was. And what really – no, it really wasn't.
Stunning recommendation.
No, I'm sorry. Let me say – no, let me be more definitive. It was actually pretty great.
It was good. It was good.
Mm. What killed the Kin was not the Kin. It was that Verizon sold it only with smartphone plans. It should have had a much less expensive plan that would have more accurately positioned it between normal phones and smartphones.
It would have been a Kin.
It was Verizon that killed it. And that stinks because that thing was actually really cool.
Well, I think you could argue that's the case in a number of cases. Verizon, not Verizon, but the carriers probably killed Windows Phone by not supporting it. So
totally, yeah.
So sure. It's Microsoft's not completely at fault with any of this.
Yeah,
no.
It's sad when a company makes a good product like the Band. I think the Band is a good product.
They're not completely at fault, but come on. It's sort of like Netscape and the whole web browser thing. Like it's not completely their own ineptitude that did it, but there were competitors involved too. It's a little bit of both. You know, I mean.
Yeah.
And the other thing is, this is just speculation. I guess that's all we do these days. But, you know, when you think about, when you think about Microsoft Band and you think about Microsoft today, I really feel like there's this imperative there that everyone justifies their existence at Microsoft. You know, that if this product needs to make sense financially, it needs to be standalone, it needs to work, it needs to be a business. Mm. And obviously the Band doesn't meet that criteria. It's just something that's never really going to make money directly for Microsoft. As part of a more cohesive series of products and services, though, Microsoft Band makes plenty of sense, especially because of the back-end Microsoft Health service, which is the type of thing Microsoft can do really, really well.
Yeah.
And it's just I think taking a small loss on the hardware, if that's what it amounted to, is something that they should have sucked up for years and years to come, because it's that back-end service that really, really matters.
So they're going to bring back Microsoft Health.
Well, it's yeah, not going away, stay. But...
Oh, what they else, didn't kill it. What else that's right. Do you Google killed theirs. I mean, yeah, right.
Yeah, well, you can't... What else does Microsoft Health even work with?
I think it works with Android devices, right?
It should work with all...
Android phones.
You know, Google has a similar thing, and it
who
works
would ever
know,
buy who such a thing and then use right. that?
Right. So you'd have to... They're going to have to reposition it and kind of make it as a health service. And they're going to have to get partners to buy in on right. it, too. Yeah. Right? But I think that's... I feel like when they came out with the band, a lot of people were like, oh, they're in the band to sell bands. But Microsoft's not really in hardware to sell hardware in a way. They're using right, hardware to showcase software and services, right?
Strategic.
Right. And hardware is a no-margin business. Like, they weren't going to get rich selling bands, but they were going to get rich, they thought.
Right.
They were going to get rich, they thought, by Microsoft Health Service and some of the other services that are powering the band. So I think that hope is still there that they can make a business off of the health service. But I don't think they ever really cared about the hardware. And, you know, once Panos Panay took over all of the hardware in the Windows and Devices group, I'm sure he also wanted to put his own stamp on it, right?
Yeah.
And so maybe that's why it goes away. Maybe something comes out like a Surface watch or a Surface fitness device someday, maybe.
Maybe, but the longer and longer we wait on these things, the less time there is for that to make any sense. Yep. You know, it's like, but we're all waiting on the Surface phone. Guys, Windows phone apps drop off the face of the earth every single day of our lives. How do you think next spring is going to be better than now?
Or later.
You know, it's like, I don't know if this is actually an ancient Chinese proverb. You know, when's the best time to plant a tree? 20 years ago. When's the second best time? Right. Today. You know, when are you going to get in the smartphone market? Ideally, you would have done it about 8 years ago. But since you didn't do that, you know, you got to do it now. You can't wait. It's not going to be easier a year from now.
Right. Or you wait till the market changes in some substantial way and try to get in then. You know?
Well, by the way, that's vaguely Microsoft's plan, right? To see right. what the next thing is and then try to be part of that.
Right.
And that's, I don't know.
But your point about apps is right. I mean... So, yeah, okay, say in 2 years, right? Say in 2 years, they say, hey, here's the Surface phone. Will there be anything to run on it at that point?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. What if they make the best phone anyone's ever seen? Will it matter
if
it doesn't run any apps?
If it's an Intel-based phone and it can run UWP apps, okay, maybe, because people are actually building some UWP apps, Universal Windows Platform. You run it through something like remote desktop services and do it that way. I don't know.
These plans all are built on these suppositions that things are going to happen. You know, a lot of people that build UWP apps are not targeting phone because it's a chicken and egg thing, right?
Yep.
So, not sure. The band thing is I have a hard time with. I mean, you could make the argument, at least with Windows Phone, that they were missing certain things early on. Windows 10 Mobile, I think, is a step back from the system. It's not doing well in the market. Like, okay. You know, the band is tough because it's not like it's this spectacular $8 billion disaster. You know, this is basically embedded wearable devices and cloud services on the back end. This is Microsoft's wheelhouse. Like, this should be... This should be where they stake a bet. You know, they should be trying to get everyone in the industry on Microsoft Health. Who are you going to trust your health data with Google? Mm. I mean, I just don't understand why this was never a bigger push than it was.
Yeah. You know, people always
Sergio,
come back
I'm
to
sorry
this.
To interrupt real quick. Sergio on Twitter says, the thing that is the next big thing might be wearables, and they're already messing that up. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, they're already messing it up. It's not good.
Sorry. Right. Sorry to interrupt.
That's a good point, though. Yeah.
Yep.
They, you know what? Microsoft should make some earbuds that have little things that come down.
That look like toothbrushes hanging out of your ears. Yeah. They should try that.
That could be a big category.
Yeah.
It's, you know what? Maybe my stuff should just give up and be an enterprise company.
Yeah.
Stop with the consumer devices. That's a tough market. What do you think
it is
now?
A tough market.
Does Satya have to go to the board and say, hey, look, we want to do a new consumer product and this is our strategy? Does he have to justify it, or can he just do it? I don't know how corporate governance works. Yeah.
Well, I would think the senior leadership team at Microsoft, which is comprised of a bunch of people who are the heads of the different groups at Microsoft, would come together and they'd talk about the idea, and then at some point have to involve the board, I would guess.
Maybe not for every product release.
No, not for every little app and service, but if it's something that is going to require kind of a big financial investment, like manufacturing capabilities or something like that for a device, I would think you would do that.
Yeah.
By the way, the other thought on kind of health, fitness wearables, and the Microsoft Band and Microsoft Health, right? Here's how you can tell that this stuff is important right now. Apple just launched the only major new product under Tim Cook a year ago, Apple Watch, right?
Yep.
Depending on who you talk to, it's either the best-selling wearable on earth or a disaster, but whatever. But they just literally changed the strategy so that this thing focuses on health and fitness.
Right.
Right.
This is so important that it has become what the Apple Watch is.
So just be clear on that, it is the best-selling smartwatch, Apple says, but they don't say what smartwatches are. I think that means they're comparing it to Android Wear, period. And it is very much a laggard in the fitness space where Fitbit
dominates.
It's not
even close to Fitbit and some of the other players, right? Yeah. Actually, not to get off on an Apple tangent, but that whole presentation, typical Apple, right? We are now the number whatever wearable. We are now the number two among luxury watchmakers, right? It's like comparing yourselves to yak herders or luxury watchmakers.
Yeah.
Who are the? We've heard of Rolex. And then we've heard of none of these other companies.
I think Casio was in there. It wasn't just luxury watches.
Okay, but luxury watches. I mean,
And who knows how
they're trying to present this face of success.
They sold a lot of watches. I mean,
Because they're Apple.
Because they're Apple. I think
Apple could start a pizza business and it would be very successful. They're very lucky. And by the way, to be fair to the watch, I mean, Apple Watch actually has improved a lot in this second generation. But part of that improvement. A big part of it is this renewed focus or new focus on fitness. It's smart. Right at a time when Microsoft is like, we're not doing the band again.
Yeah.
Like, seriously, it has to make crazy. It makes me crazy.
Is there, there's more
they
money.
They haven't said they aren't. They haven't said they aren't. I should be clear.
This is a rumor.
They have not, if I were Microsoft at this point and these stories were coming out, I would just say, we are going to do another band and we're not going to tell you anything
else. If they're
going
to, they should say
blah.
And the fact that they haven't, you think, is indicative.
I do think so. And the way that statement they sent us was worded, that we're going to continue to explore wearables, that is a pretty wide open thing. Like, I was thinking, okay, is a HoloLens a wearable? I guess so.
Do you find it interesting that Tim Cook said that he didn't really yesterday that he didn't think virtual reality was the next big thing, but augmented reality, a la HoloLens, was.
Interesting.
That's where Microsoft should double down, because there's an
I think they are.
Yeah, and they are, aren't they? We've heard that they are.
Yeah.
I don't know.
They are.
I hear such conflicting things. I will say on the wearables side, it's not just the statement Microsoft put out. There are sources at Microsoft who have provided certain bits of information that, point very strongly at the fact that, band is not happening. It's not as simple as a statement, for one thing. HoloLens, I don't know how often I can just beat this one to death. I mean, the technology is obviously really exciting. It's also
a long way
years
off.
Away from being,
But
it is.
You should pick,
viable.
If you're Microsoft, something that's a long way off as well as something that's near.
Yes. Right. No, I agree with that. But you also, selling a version of it that doesn't work is not necessarily a great strategy.
But that was a developer edition, right? I mean, they didn't sell that to
consumers. They're selling it to businesses now.
Oh, they are? Oh.
Yeah, it's not like it's any different.
Oh, that's not good. They need to be very clear. This
is
a developer edition.
It works, but it doesn't work the way that a lot of people who have never tried it thinks it works.
Expect it to work. Yeah.
I've had better experience with Google Cardboard, period. I'm sorry. I just have. I know it's not the same thing.
That says a lot. And Google Cardboard's almost $3,000 cheaper.
It's whatever the cost is of HoloLens cheaper. yeah. No, I'm serious. And I think
well,
that
phone-based
augmented reality solutions, Pokemon Go being a very simplistic example, Project Tango from Google or Android being a great example, and Tim Cook's statement, because Tim Cook's not coming out with a HoloLens. Tim Cook is coming out with something that's going to feed the iPhone monster. And clearly when they talk about augmented reality.
Something else. Yeah.
It's going to be an iPhone focus.
Yeah.
And I do think there's a big future for this stuff.
It's going to be a crowded field because Google's got Magic Leap. It's going to be a crowded field. It's not.
Yeah.
Or Leap. Leap Motion, not Magic Leap. Right. Apple has Magic Leap. Who has? Yeah. I don't know. I can't keep track of it.
No, you know, when I was saying wearables and HoloLens, you know what I was thinking of is somewhere in the future, they're going to make something more like Google Glass that is HoloLens, right? So it's glasses. I mean, I don't really know what they mean when they're saying wearables. And what I will tell you is, if you look at people who are who've been working on the band, if you do a little LinkedIn search on them, a lot of them are on HoloLens and band together, which is interesting that those two things are grouped together.
You could picture a wearable that worked in tandem with the HoloLens.
Yep. Yep. Right. We're guessing again, but yep. I'm sure they have a lot of things they're trying out, testing, Panos's lab, Dr. Evil's lab. He's got a bunch of little projects
Dr.
over there.
Dr. Evil's lab, is that what you said?
Panos, yes. Dr. Evil.
Yep. I think we talked about this on Windows Weekly previously, this notion that, you know, they come up with HoloLens, it's all going to be about pinching and stuff. And then they realize, you know, actually we need some kind of controller. It's sort of like virtual reality systems. They also have these weird little controller things. It's not, you can have a video game controller, obviously, but they all seem to have some little thing because you need something a little more precise than, you know, that goofy pose you have to do to try to select things in the air with a pinch, you know?
Right.
And I think that that's what happens. You know, Kinect was all about gestures, but it really is all about voice, you know?
Yeah.
When you put something out in the world, things happen and you kind of have to change directions, what Apple just did with the watch.
Yep.
We'll see what sticks. Fitness stuck. That's where they're going. You know, the HoloLens, it might end up in a slightly different place than it started. Mm. At Apple. No, I'm just kidding. But you know what I mean? Like, it's just... It's I think just opening something up to other people is what influences the future. You know, it goes in a direction that may be not the thing you originally envisioned, but it's more natural for the product.
Right.
Let's take a break. What do you say?
Sure.
I want to chew on that for a while. And while I'm chewing on that, maybe you'd like to get an IT certificate and get a better job. How about that? Hmm? Or maybe you'd like, maybe you're already in IT and you'd like to perfect your skills. You know, keeping up is tough these days, right? There's stuff moves fast. That's why I love IT Pro TV. IT Pro TV is for the IT pro who's constantly learning. It's for the person who wants to get into IT. We meet people all the time who are fans of technology, who listen to our shows or even going back to Tech TV, watch those shows and said, I want to do that. This is my next job. I'm going to stop being whatever, a truck driver or, a restaurateur or whatever. And I've talked to people in all fields, accountant. I want to be in IT because I love technology. Well, here's how you do it. If you've never worked in IT before, having a cert makes a big difference. So you want to get those certifications. That's how IT Pro TV started. In fact, Don and Tim, who are the founders, had been teaching people, giving them classes so they could take those tests and get those certs for years. They saw what we were doing here at TWIT. They were big fans of Tech TV, and they said, "Ooh, let's do that. Let's do a 24/7 channel with live streaming, a chat room, and there's Don. He's macking. There's Tim. A live streaming channel, but instead of, you know, the general content that TWIT does, let's do IT content. Now they've got thousands of hours in their library, more than 30 hours at it every week. They've just built new studios like we did, but they have five studios. In fact, we're going out to the grand opening next month in Florida. It's so cool. You can stream their courses live and on demand,
And you can do it worldwide on a Chromecast, on a Roku, on a Fire TV, an Apple TV, a PC. They even sell individual courses on Amazon Video Direct. They're the first IT company to do that. You can learn at your own pace. You can learn on the go with a mobile device. Courses include everything Microsoft, you know, MCSA and Windows, how to run Windows servers, how to do IT, CCENT, CCNA, routing and switching, CISM. I love the Certified Ethical Hacker courses. Those are cool, too. They've got transcripts of every course. They really do put a lot of care into the editing, the production. The transcripts are a great way to kind of follow along or jump to a particular part of the video. The virtual machine lab means you don't have to have a Windows PC to set up Windows Server, to set up a network, to configure many clients, because you can do it all on any device with an HTML5 browser. That's really awesome. They also let you take the exam before you take the exam with the Transcender practice exams. That's a $109 value. So, if you're currently, by the way, there are other, apparently, I'm not going to name names, but there's a competitor, IT Pro TV competitor, that has just raised the prices on their enterprise accounts. If you are one of those corporate accounts and you don't like this big increase, IT Pro TV has said they will match your previous year's pricing on that account. Hey, they're going to take advantage of this and move you over. So you and your team can learn at an affordable rate. IT Pro TV's clients include some of the best universities in the world. Of course, many of the best companies. I can't talk about the companies, but I'll tell you, Harvard, they bought IT Pro TV for the entire IT team at Harvard University, MIT, UCSD, Stanford. It's very affordable, a lot more affordable than a technical school, and it's kind of fun. I mean, you can have it on, you know, on your Roku and then get in the car and be listening on your phone and get to work and watch it on your computer. And it's kind of all you can eat, $57 a month, $570 a year. But we got a better deal for you. If you go to itpro.tv/ww and use the code WW30, you're going to get a 7-day free trial. You can cancel then. It's easy to cancel, by the way, because, you know, they're geeks and they understand. They don't want to trap you. They just do a great product, so you don't have to worry about it. You're going to also get 30% off, and not just for the first year, but forever, for the lifetime of your account. So now it's really affordable, $40 a month, or subscribe for a year. There are advantages to getting a year subscription, not the least of which is you get 2 months free, $399 for a year. And frankly, that's enough to not only get the job, but, you know, get the certs, get the job, and then keep up with all the technology as it changes. And it's fun. You'll enjoy it. itpro.tv/ww. The offer code is WW30. Try it free for 7 days and get 30% off forever. They're great guys. Can't wait to go out and see the new studios. I'm a little jealous. itpro.tv. Use the offer code WW30. Paul Thurrott, Mary Jo Foley. We're talking Windows on Windows Weekly with two of the best Windows journalists in the world. Do we talk? Is there anything to say about Windows 10 anymore? Or is it over? It's done. We're just like all
it's baked.
Yeah, done.
It's done. We don't have to talk about it anymore. I just got an update because it was Patch Tuesday, right on Tuesday.
Yep.
And I'm stuck at 95%. I've been stuck for 2 days.
Oh, no.
Or a day on 95%. I don't understand.
Could be worse, Leo. You could be waiting for the anniversary update.
Are there still people?
Oh, yes.
Yes,
what?
Sir.
Really? Actually, that's not a bad thing. I think Microsoft had some problems with the anniversary update. Maybe they slowed it down a little because of it, right? Don't
that
rush.
Seems to be the case.
Don't rush, in other words.
Yep. It's funny. On September 1st, I didn't really look at this email when it came into my inbox, but then I went back and looked at it. I got this email on September 1st that said, Windows 10 anniversary update is coming soon. And I'm like, that's odd. That's like a month after it first
Any
came
day
out.
Now.
All right. And then I looked at the footnote and it said, you know what? It may take us up to 3 months to roll out Windows 10 anniversary
what?
To all users.
Really?
Yep.
Wow.
So November 2nd is the end target date for this.
If you're compatible.
If you're compatible. Right.
I'm guessing there is a number of machines that they don't want to push it to. Did they fix the VGA or the camera webcam thing, right, with the MP4 codec or whatever it was?
Paul, did they fix that?
Oh, really? They might not have fixed that yet.
Did they fix the webcam thing? I can't remember.
Right. I don't believe so. And I think somebody, I probably just saw this on Twitter. I think somebody today said something about that. You know, like they maybe, you know, some of the cumulative update or something could fix this, but I don't believe that's the case.
Right. They did fix the PowerShell desired state configuration problem. I don't think they've yet fixed the Kindle problem that some of the paper whites were.
I was going to try that.
Working.
I forgot.
I don't think that's been fixed yet. But you know what? What both Paul and I, we've been digging around on this, and what we've been hearing from our contacts is this is a staged rollout because of stuff like this. Like they can watch what's breaking, what's not working compatibility-wise, and say, you know what? Hold on. Let's slow this down. Or
well, that's fine. I mean, do that for sure, right?
Right. I'm totally okay with not getting it if they know it's not going to work on my Acer S7.
Right.
I'm great with that.
No rush. No hurry.
Right.
Take your time, guys. Get it right.
Yeah. And if you are a user who is tech-savvy enough and cares enough about the anniversary update and you want to take the chance, you can go get it proactively. We've talked about that.
If you
know, it's not like you're at Microsoft's will.
Tool, you know. You can just install it from there.
Right.
Okay.
You can. Yeah. But I think it's good that they're... I wish they had told us that they were how they were doing this and why they were doing this and why it was going to take a while. I wish they had been a little more explicit.
I don't think this was their plan. I think that they were surprised by the incompatibilities, right?
I don't know.
Yeah, I do think there was an element of surprise, right? I
have to think so. Because they had this big data test. How many millions of people were using the anniversary update for months?
Right. Yeah. It's several millions, right? I mean, I know there was a 5 million figure at one point or maybe an 8 million figure. That doesn't mean they were all active and you know.
Oh, but it would give, I would expect, especially with all the telemetry Microsoft gets, it would give them some sense of confidence that they could roll this out.
Yeah. Well, we talked about this a couple weeks ago. I think there's some evidence that the process works, right? I think that when those problems did occur with the Kindle, with the webcam, and whatever else, they were able to turn those machines off for getting the update, right? And that's solving a lot of problems, right? People who might have a bad experience down the road won't know. That's smart. It's better for them to stay on the previous version. On the other hand, you can kind of make this argument that somebody at Microsoft or some buddies, you know, made a platform change with the thing that caused the webcam issue. It affected X number of people. We don't know if it's millions or whatever, but some group of people. How did that get through? and we know people complained about it during the beta.
Yeah.
How was that not escalated? You know, there's no way to know. I mean, this is Microsoft is a very transparent company in the scheme of the tech industry and all that kind of stuff. But I think there are some things like this. We're never really going to know the
right.
You know, the deep inner workings of how these things happen, but I think it's fair to say, in the wake of these escapades or events,
shenanigans,
well, the things are going to change for the next update, right? I mean, we've identified problems—not Mary Jo and I, but I mean, you know, the whole world—that Microsoft didn't catch during the beta, and they would prefer to catch it during the beta. So I think there'll be some changes.
Yeah,
they're going to fire all those internal testers.
Okay, so let's talk about internal
testers. Fire the insiders.
Yeah, Let's talk about internal testers, because this comes up every single time we talk about quality.
How many people know this. It's amazing how many people know this.
So 2 years ago, Microsoft had one of their waves of layoffs, and they did lay off a bunch of Windows testers. They did. The urban myth that sprung up around this was they laid off every single Windows tester.
Well, the quality control has gone down way, you know, ever since that time. It seems like it's
but
been terrible
still
over there.
You know, I've tried to pin them down on this. I'm like, how do you guys actually have a bunch of Windows testers? And can you tell us how many and like, what are they doing and how does this work? And they don't want to talk about that. I've been poking around and I think they still have hundreds of internal testers. I don't know if it's thousands, but I think they have hundreds.
We know they have automated suites of machines.
They
have millions of people testing this thing. Millions.
They do. Right.
Do you think a couple hundred people sitting in a building somewhere at Microsoft is gonna be what puts this over the top?
No, I don't. I don't think so. But I do think the way that they've structured how, like you just said, banks of machines, tons of telemetry. I think they have systems in place where some of these things should have been caught or could have been caught. But that said, you know, there are so many combinations and permutations of Windows machines, and this comes up a lot. Like, okay, there may be, you know, say 10 of us are sitting here all running the HP Spectre, right? But we all have slightly different software installed. We all have slightly different applications installed, different drivers. And so you have to test for every single one of these combinations, basically, to really test everything. The part is, we don't, like you just said, we don't know how many people are hit when these problems happen. Like the webcam thing, was it 100 people affected? Was it 1 million? We don't have any way to know that, right?
Yeah, and I will say this, based on the feedback that I've received, right, I feel confident saying it wasn't every single person that had this webcam, right? Because it's very easy to say every single person who has a Logitech C290 experienced freezing issues when they used video with Skype. That's actually not the case.
Right.
So,
yep.
What was it then? Was it 11 people or was it 11 million people?
We don't know.
There's no way for us to know this.
No. Huh. Okay. We've got David Painter on Twitter says the latest build today fixes the Kindle problems.
Okay. Maybe that's where I heard this. Okay. Maybe it was today. It's today's Insider build that fixes them. Okay.
Yeah. So it's the Insider build.
Oh, okay.
Not the cumulative update for people who are doing the anniversary update.
Does that mean they're testing... They're testing it, and then...
Yeah, they're testing it.
Yeah.
Yep. But, you know, right, just like you said about the camera, same thing with the Kindle. Not every single person who had a Paperwhite who plugged it into a Windows 10 anniversary had a meltdown. Not everybody did. Some did. But why was it only some? Right?
So, in that case, I did, so clearly it happens to everybody.
Clearly, but
because my experiences millions, are universal,
billions.
Yep.
Right. Because when that bug came up, I called Microsoft. I said, you know, how many people are experiencing this? Well, we can't tell you. I'm like, is it everyone? No. Is it a large number? No. It's a small number. Okay. But what's a small number?
So here's the problem. I'm sure there are legal implications to this, but Microsoft does make a statement about this kind of thing, it's always very brief, and it always involved, you know, for example, we saw this week on the Surface firmware updates, you know, this issue or this fix is for an issue that impacted a very small number of users, and that's like all they'll ever say, you know, and very small for Microsoft could be any number, right?
Million, I mean,
they have billions of customers.
I know, right.
It's hard to say, but I wish, you know, this is an area where I think Microsoft could do something for our collective psyche and just... be a little more open about it and talk about it a little bit more.
Yeah, I think it would be good for them also, because otherwise we immediately jump to conclusions, us who are writing about this, that, oh, it's everybody, right? You're like, like millions of people, right?
Oh, I'm a reaction nerve. I'm waiting.
You're the originator of the Gates. You're Mr. Gates, but not Bill Gates.
No, not that
Not
Gates.
That Gates. So,
all right.
But if you don't have anniversary update, my advice to you as a normal is just sit tight and wait and don't go get it because maybe there's a really good reason.
Yeah. Don't rush.
And if you're like she said, like Mary Jo said earlier, if you're technical, you can go get the ISO and upgrade right now.
Right.
So
right now.
It's built in, it's baked into the official Windows 10 ISO.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
And what's the Centennial Bridge? I see. What's the latest with the Centennial Bridge? Is that an actual bridge?
Yes. It's
it is
Panama.
In real life.
Oh, okay. But that's not the one you're talking about.
No.
Do you want this one?
Or you can. Go ahead.
Don't fight, kids.
Whoever wants it. I can talk about
I got some feedback early in the show that the show's better when Mary Jo talks.
No.
I can chime in. Go ahead. I can chime in as you. Oh,
this is your chance to show your stuff. Okay. Strut your stuff, Thurrott.
All right, listen. at Build 2015, Microsoft introduced four bridges, right, aimed at bringing universal Windows platform apps to Windows 10. And one of those bridges was what we're now calling, well, it was Centennial, which has a really strange name. It's like the Desktop App Converter, which is actually the name of the tool. It's a way to bring Win32 and .NET apps, desktop apps, into the Windows Universal Windows platform. It's basically just a wrapper, and it allows a desktop application to be sold or given away through the store. And so if you just do nothing more than wrap your desktop application as a universal Windows platform app using Project Centennial or the desktop converter, what you get is something that is safer and more secure than a desktop app because it's sandboxed. You get something that could be installed very easily from a known trusted location, the Windows Store. And you get something that could be uninstalled with one click. And that when you do uninstall that thing, you don't have DLL files and other junk all over your file system. And so it's just more reliable, better security and safety just across the board. That's without doing anything other than packaging wrap using Centennial. But you can also go further than that, and you can add things like support for universal Windows platform app features like live tiles, notifications, and other things. And so it's generally available now. Anyone can download it from the store, this tool that converts apps. And they don't really have too many high-profile developers or application makers using this yet, but the biggest one is Evernote. And we talked about this probably 2 or 3 weeks ago. Evernote released their desktop app as a UWP app in the store, and they got rid of their old mobile app. When they released that app originally, I think it was at the end of August, it was just the app. It was just the same exact app you would get off the Evernote website, you know, packaged as UWP. This week, though, they're upgrading it, and they're actually starting to support UWP features, like I said, including notifications and live tile support and some other stuff, too. They're actually adapting the app in other ways. And so that's the dream of the Centennial Bridge, that these developers won't just package their apps, which is great. It's better than nothing. But also take advantage of UWP features. You know, it's a way to get UWP apps into the store without requiring someone who already has a long-lived app to, you know, restart it from scratch. And so it's generally available today. I think that was the primary news. The Evernote app has been updated. Because it's now a store app, it will be updated automatically for developers that do use it. And it's free.
I'm going to have to try it. Is it noticeably different?
From the way it was before, you mean?
Yeah.
No, I mean, I think it was just a pre-release version before.
But is it so different from the previous
I should say
client?
The biggest difference is it comes from the store now, right? Before get it.
It was a download from Evernote. So, okay. So,
yeah.
But feature-wise, it's not, right? Like, it's the exact same set of features as you get if you just downloaded it, right?
Does it look I believe different? It is the same set of features, yeah.
I think it is the same.
Yeah.
Unless you do what Paul said, and then you take the next step, and then you start adding in the UWP features. Like, you know, once you do that first step, which is get your app in the store, second step, add the UWP features. Then it starts to look different and probably has a different feature set to some extent.
It could. I've not used it. This is some, you know, like Raphael, for example, has used this thing a lot. And I need to talk to him about this. One thing I'm curious about with Centennial from sort of a Windows enthusiast standpoint is, could I just as a user take the Chrome installer or the iTunes installer and wrap this thing up as a UWP app, right? And then sideload it because you can trigger a thing in settings in Windows 10 that will allow that. And could I just kind of collect these things over on the side and only use UWP versions of desktop apps? I don't know. Probably not.
Like the vendor must have to be the one to do it, right?
I don't know. I used to do packaging of desktop apps for like corporate distribution through various systems. You know, Windows Intune does something like this where you could just do this to any app. You could take the Adobe installer, you could take the Office installer back in the day and just kind of package it up. So I don't know if it works exactly like that, but I could see it going either way. But obviously what you don't want to get is third parties offering other companies apps, you know, in Universal Windows platform app packages. So
that could get a little weird and complicated.
Yes, right.
Yeah, right. So the other reason Microsoft's trying to get people to take the Win32 app and then actually go the next step and go and make it a UWP app is because if you do that, then the app doesn't just run on Windows laptops. It can also, with adjustments, run on Xbox One and HoloLens and Surface Hubs and Windows phones because it's a UWP app. The way it just goes, if you just take it, go ahead.
Is that true?
Yeah, I asked them that. Yep.
Isn't that what universal means, Paul?
Listen, Twitter, pedantically, yes, but well, no, I mean, I, you know, universal is a capital U. It's kind of a, it's a name.
Oh,
so I mean, right. if it was right. truly universal,
I thought that was the promise of the whole thing was that it'll run everywhere.
It is. It's like it gives you the common core, right? If you really go all the way and make it a UWP app, you have the common core that so that in theory you don't need to do a whole lot to so, put on other platforms.
I wish Raphael was listening to this because he could tell me the truth on this one, but. In the same way that you can target specific platforms with the UWP app.
Oh, yeah, you could probably say
I would be surprised if Centennial only. Apps were, in fact, constrained only to the desktop.
Yeah.
But I
I think they are.
Oh, okay, that's what I meant. Okay, right.
Yeah.
Okay, that's, I think that, they that are. That would be my expectation, because it's still Win32 apps.
Yeah, you know, I asked Microsoft that.
Because
still
connect to those things.
Right, yeah. Right. So, you know, in the blog post they did about this today, they talked about it running on Surface Hub and HoloLens and everything else. And then I went back to them and I said, but I can't do it now, right? They have to go beyond Win32 app in the store. It doesn't mean that'll run on Xbox One. And they said, no, this is the first step. The next step is you make it a UWP app. Then you can use it on things other than the PC.
All right, so let's look one up, because I know, for example,
yeah,
it's not coming up with anything.
Is it,
well, we know
should
Evernote.
It be a concern for users that it's 32-bit? I mean, we made this whole big thing about 64-bit and everything. Everything's going 64-bit, and then all of a sudden it feels like, to the untutored mind, of which I am one, oh, we're going back to 32-bit now.
Leo, no one will ever need more than 32 bits.
I actually used to argue there's no point in going to 64 bits except for the memory addressing, because other than that,
yep.
In fact, you could slow things down because of the larger word size and stuff like that. But
but aren't we using Win32 here kind of like a generic term? I mean,
well, I don't
doesn't,
know. Are we? What are we?
Well,
doing?
I'm not a developer.
Why
so
would
I'm not
you
gonna,
say it if it's not true?
Well, because a lot of people call Win32 apps, like I feel like some people call Win64 apps Win32 apps. It's just like a name.
So it's not, has nothing to do with bit size, word size. It has to do with the API. This is the Win32 API.
It's a .NET app, right? Win32 /.NET apps, I think.
Okay, right. Okay. No, that's right. You're right.
Okay. So it's not a 32-bit app. It's just the 32-bit API. Well, no, it's not even that. It's the Win32 API. Forget the word you ever heard the word bit.
Yeah,
right.
It's a classic,
right. Sorry, I didn't.
Classic Windows app.
Okay. So that was what I was asking. Is it 32-bit? Yeah. No.
I gotcha. Okay.
It's just the
So you can, as a universal Windows platform app maker, I believe. I think you pretty much just target x86. Could you specify that it only runs on x64 systems? I don't know enough about this to say, but I don't believe so. I think it's x86 ARM, you know, HoloLens specifically. Xbox One specifically, that kind of thing. IoT.
ARM
probably.
Might be the key.
But these apps aren't going to run on ARM. The ARM systems don't have the Win32 stuff in them that's still going to be needed to run those apps.
Oh.
Right? It's sandboxed from the system, but it doesn't have the complete Win32, you know, runtime in there. Like it's just, you know, it's to the computer, the files are spread all over the computer like they're supposed to be. It's just faking out the namespaces probably. Like it still needs to access the stuff that's in Windows. So if that doesn't exist, like it wouldn't on ARM, it's not going to work. It still has to be on an x86 platform, a PC, essentially.
Right. But yeah, that's Centennial, and that's the last of the bridges. That's the last of the bridges, right? Like now
we
know about all the other bridges. We know about the iOS bridge, which is Islandwood, and Web App Bridge, which was Westminster, I think. And then there was a Silverlight Bridge, and they killed the Android Bridge, which was Astoria. And we haven't heard any plans to bring that back. People ask me that all the time. Are they going to bring the Android Bridge back?
I mean, the guys who were on that team are on the iOS
team. They're gone. Right. They're gone off that team now. Yeah. So.
Not to bring up this old topic, but when they announced the bridges for iOS and Android, when they were still both an ongoing concern, it was strange to me in a way how different they were. Because if you think about it, why wouldn't there be a consistent way of bringing apps from these two platforms to Windows? They were very, very different. And I think part of the reason was that Android apps could run natively on a Windows phone because it was the same underlying platform. That was probably the rationale behind it. But it is kind of strange how inconsistent those things were to each other.
Yeah.
Well, earlier in the show, I said, Paul and Mary Jo are going to show you how you can use Microsoft Edge and get paid. And now is the time.
I can't tell you how uncomfortable I am with that topic. I didn't write this story, but the basic gist of it is Microsoft really wants you to use Microsoft Edge to the point where, you know, they've changed their rewards program. You get a lot, you know, you have to agree to get tracked. I was talking to Brad about this. You know, do we believe, is there some kind of privacy thing here where Microsoft has to ensure that you're actually browsing the web with this thing? How do they determine that this is the active application? How do they determine that you are, in fact, using it? You know, is there some software application I could run that would just sit there and have web browse automatically around the web all day long, and then I could get 3,000 points at the end of the week or whatever? And I don't know. So as with everything Windows 10 related, it seems we have to consider these issues. But yeah, their new promotion is, you know, you can earn points not by traveling and not by eating out, but by browsing
the
web.
They're the, like, Xbox Live Microsoft points.
Well, it's what used to be the Bing Rewards program, which is I think has been rebranded, right, to the...
Oh, so this is the Bing Rewards program. Okay.
Yeah.
Right.
Oh,
now called Microsoft Rewards.
I get it.
Bing Rewards is gone.
Yeah. Yeah. I never did get it.
But
any
you also
rewards.
Still do you still get points for Bing too? I think that's still part of this.
Yeah,
right?
I think that's still a thing and still separate. Yeah. Like you can do that through the mobile apps even if you want to use it on Android or iOS and get Bing. Yeah, get points. And it's the same. It's probably the same exact thing actually in the back end, right? Yeah. You're getting the same points you can buy. I haven't done this in a long time, but I used to get little Groove credits and things like that from using Bing Rewards.
It'd be kind of cool if, like, every time you used Edge, like, they had. Maybe they'll do this on the new, what do they call in the notes? The new Surface Office?
Microsoft Reward. Oh, I'm sorry.
If they had
the Cardinal.
The Cardinal had a little, this is my dream.
Yep.
It had a little thing on the side that tickets came out. And you go,
and every time the ticket came out, it would go,
and then you tear off the tickets, and there's a, you go to the counter, and you can get a pencil, pen and pencil set. Or like a little cardinal on your for your eraser on your pen, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
But maybe that's the dream only I share. All right, moving on.
Maybe. Maybe.
Sorry. Moving on. You get a lot of support for that one. I apologize.
Moving on. Sunrise, sunset. So I'm still mad that Microsoft bought Sunrise, which was a great calendar app, and killed it now. But bits of it are starting to reappear, float to the surface.
Oil animated slick. Little zombie bits are showing up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Where are we seeing it and why? I mean, how?
So, you know what? I have to look today. I never got this update. So, they've updated Outlook on Android and iOS, and I checked on both platforms to support some additional features that they, some of which were inspired by Sunrise. Not all of them, but some of them were.
Interesting calendars is one.
I know, which is such a great name.
Actually, use that because it's got the 49ers schedule.
Oh, yeah.
And
sure.
And I'll know when Ramadan is and stuff like that is useful.
Yeah.
Well, they added this to the web versions of Outlook, right? Outlook.com, the new version, and Outlook on the web, I don't know, a few weeks ago. And I remember seeing the headline, you know, Microsoft adds sports schedules to Outlook. And I thought to myself, wow, I really. Really catching up with iCal there from like 1998. Nice job, or whatever year that was. Like seriously,
yeah,
like
that's true.
This is a feature that's just been around forever. Yeah. But anyway, it's a cool thing. Obviously, right now it's just sports. Though it seems like there could be a lot more in there. But yeah,
so I bet they'll add more for sure.
Yeah.
And then that other thing where if you schedule a coffee with someone, the coffee cup icon. Yeah.
Right, which
up.
Sounds goofy, you know, like emoji-like, but actually, I think they're right.
Helpful,
you know,
because you can
because you
at
see
glance.
The little picture, and it. Yeah. I think that makes a connection in your brain faster than reading text. Yeah.
Well, you just know it's like you can look at your day and you see, oh yeah, I'm doing this, and this.
Yeah,
and that's using
pencil, sleep, coffee, pencil.
Lots of writing.
Xbox.
Yeah, right. Call of Duty.
So I'll tell you, I've talked to a few people on Twitter today who got this update, and they've been saying they've been having problems with it. So I don't know.
Good.
I don't know if that meant they throttled it or if they're going back to the drawing board with it. I don't know how widespread the problem is, but one guy said, I got the update on Outlook Mobile, yeah, I think last night, and he said, now none of my devices can connect to my calendar.
So I still don't have it.
Yeah. I don't think I have it either on mine. So maybe, you know, it started to roll out and then people were like, wait, hold on. Whoops. Yeah, I don't have it either.
So yeah, I actually use Outlook on both of these platforms. And I saw this and I thought, you know, great. But I haven't seen it yet.
Yeah, I have Outlook Mobile on my Nexus. And I use it a lot. So, yeah, we'll see. It just may be a case where there was some hiccups. I don't know, again, how widespread, but I did see some people reporting issues.
Do you think it will be November before we get this update?
It might be. Or later, if you're Paul Thurrott and you're trying to get the new Outlook.com.
right. Yeah, you can't You can't get it until you have the new Outlook.com.
Speaking of the new Outlook.com, have too. I've been hearing from tons of people who in the past few days are getting the new
version. Stop it.
Oh, tons of them. Tons.
Mike, Paul,
and
have you...
Guess who one of them
isn't.
Even people
with shared calendars. Even shared calendar people and some with Windows Live. Like people who they said were going to be at the very end. So I'm thinking we're getting towards the end, but I know Paul does not have it yet.
Is that the new Outlook? Is that it?
If it says Outlook Mail on the top, new.
Old.
If it says Outlook.com, it is the old. Sorry, guys.
I've had this account since, I don't know if it's 2000 or 2001. It was whenever Microsoft added Xbox Live to the original Xbox for Halo, I think it was Halo 2.
Do you think that's why we're...
whenever that was.
It's like
I know, the oldest accounts are the last accounts.
Yeah, we're stuck like a crumb in the corner and...
Yeah, right.
They just can't...
Yep.
Yeah.
Like a crumb in the corner. That's going to be the title of my autobiography. Thank you for saying that. That's perfect.
I'm the crumb in the corner.
Like a crumb in the corner. That's exactly what I am.
Oh. Yep. I think it's kind of humorous that both of us, you and I, there must be something we have in common. It must be...
Yes, funny.
Something.
You're not the only ones who don't have it. Every day I hear from people, I still don't have it. Why don't I have it? Yeah.
Again, couldn't care less, but it's just weird.
Let's see. It must say somewhere how old my account is. I can't find it, but.
Yeah. Anyway, it's good news that more and more people are getting it.
Yes, it is.
I think I've heard from every one of them, all of whom stopped by Twitter to mock me.
I know. They do. They go, Mary Jo and Paul.
I
have the new Outlook.
I got it.
Did you get it yet?
No, I'm a crumb in the corner.
That's good.
Ryan Hill on Twitter. I don't have the new Outlook. Maybe I should unfollow Thurrott.
Ah, that's it. We're all Thurrott followers. That's it.
Nice. Yep. Yeah, that's what it
guilt
is.
By association. I'm the lettuce in your tooth.
It's so awful to say it this way, but part of me sort of imagines somewhere in Microsoft, someone's like, would you just give it to this guy so he'll shut the hell up?
No, they're loving this. Are you kidding?
Yeah.
They are.
Somebody's put out the memo, under no circumstances, give Thurrott the new Outlook.
Right. And every time you tease them on Twitter, I'm like, you're going further back on the line.
I know. I'm so terrible.
You're bad. You're bad.
That's really funny. He's gonna
fall.
Anyway.
Well,
what else?
That's life. That's life. All right. I'm gonna take a break. But here's some good news that you know those New York City kiosks, Mary Jo, with the high speed Wi-Fi and all that. I don't know why they thought this was a good idea, but you probably noticed that there's a web browser screen right in there. Turns out those are magnets for drunks and porno fanatics.
Yes, they are. Yes, they are.
And they're removing them.
Oh, they are? Wow.
Why was this not immediately obvious?
Oh, man. You should see people coagulating around.
Is that true? Really?
God, it's like moths going to a light.
Oh, man. You see a pile of people around one of these, and then you look over, you're like, oh, I'm not going over there.
Turns out it's really a problem. Where would you think? In Midtown.
Times Square for sure.
Oh, Times Square. That's why Midtown. Yep. Okay.
Yep.
Okay.
Elected officials, according to the New York Times, have demanded changes in the system, saying they're overwhelmed with complaints from residents and businesses about people spending hours entertaining themselves.
Yeah, that's a nice euphemism.
I'm never using those again. 8th Avenue, several problematic kiosks.
Times Square.
Yeah.
Not the kiosks that are problematic, it's the user.
Uh-huh. Often monopolized by individuals creating personal spaces for themselves. Engaging in activities that include playing loud music, consuming drugs and alcohol, and watching porn. Oh, it's like your house. It's like your house.
You're describing a Starbucks.
Holy cow.
And you know what's right in that area? Roughly Microsoft's brand new New York City headquarters.
Oh, the headquarters.
I was going to say, you're not too far from there. I mean, there's one right on the other side of Penn Station.
Why they didn't know this would be a problem, kind of.
Right, that's what I mean. You don't have to be a social engineer to know, hey, what do you think will happen if we throw a free screen with internet on it out in public?
Right.
Well, when you put it that way.
Yeah,
people will swing by and they should check their email, and then they'll move on. That's what people do.
Wi-Fi is pretty fast too.
It's good Wi-Fi. What they should do is they should make them like those automated toilets now from France that they have.
They just wash themselves every time you leave.
They hose it down after each use.
They should hose it down, but they should hose down in front of it. You know, if you've been standing there for too long, it's time to get the hose.
Nice. Moving on. Nah, it's nice. Moving on. Moving on. I thought, wow.
Yeah, that's crazy.
On the other hand, if they had used Edge, you could get paid while you're doing it. Our show today brought to you by Carbonite Online Backup. These guys are the kings of online backup, the best in the biz. And surely, and I'm talking to a Windows Weekly audience, I don't have to explain to you that you need backup. By now, every one of you has been bit, let's hope many, many, many years ago. I was talking with the guy who invented Gopher on Triangulation on Monday, and Archie about backup, because the source code he had written a large VRML, virtual reality markup language, basically a 3D environment 20 years ago, you know, and the source code was lost. Apparently, at the University of Minnesota, their servers, every file greater than 96K got corrupted. And they didn't have a backup. And he and the reason it's a story, it's in his Wikipedia entry, is because somebody contacted him like 5 years ago and said, you don't have the source code. He said, of course I have the source code. He said, I back up. And so he recontributed it so they could recreate it. So everybody at one point or another probably has lost data. Don't do it. And I guess when I'm talking to you Windows Weekly viewers and listeners, I'm talking about your friends and family. Turn them on to Carbonite. First of all, you don't want that agonized call in the middle of the night. What do I do? And you don't want to be the one who has to say, well, you're going to be spending some money on data recovery services. Oh, the worst call. I'm seeing this pop-up that says it's from the FBI, and I have to pay them $300 in Bitcoin. What's that all about? If I ever want to see my data again, they got bit by ransomware, and it's very common now. Carbonite's a solution, the fix for ransomware, because it does versioning. So if you're using Carbonite for Windows, and if it's a business, you know, it's hard to control your employees. 90% of all these phishing emails are really spear phishing emails aimed at your employees. And they open it, and boom, your whole network now is corrupted. You got Carbonite Cloud Backup running. You don't have to worry. You go back to the version prior to the infection, and all your data is still there. They've backed up now over 500 billion files. More than 1.5 million homes and small businesses trust Carbonite to back up their computers and servers. From spreadsheets and emails to financial records to digital photos to music, Carbonite's the one. Try it free. You don't need a credit card. So this is my kind of free trial. You just try it. And they're not going to bill you because they don't have any billing information. So you just see if you like it. But the one thing I'd ask you to do is use the offer code WINDOWS to benefit Paul and Mary Jo, because that way Carbonite will know, you heard this on Windows Weekly. And they'll give you, as a thank you, two free bonus months if you decide to buy. That's a good deal. You got to back it up to get it back. Do it right with Carbonite, C-A-R-B-O-N-I-T-E, Carbonite.com. And don't forget that offer code, Windows. Paul Thurrott, Mary Jo Foley. We're talking Windows, Windows Weekly. Moving on to the head count. Oh, no, you want to do mobile first? No, we did that. Let's do the head count watch. Yeah. Time to talk about head count, kids. People are leaving Microsoft? Why ever would you leave Microsoft?
Well, I get my porn at Times Square now. I don't have to.
So, you know, it's funny. Around this time of year, right, because Microsoft has mid-year reviews that happen over the summer. Right around now, a lot of people, maybe because either they got a bad review or they spent their summer off and they were kind of thinking about the meaning of life, they decide to retire and move on. So I've been collecting names and looking for people who've been leaving lately, and there's some pretty big name people leaving Microsoft right now. I think we may have mentioned Bill Lang recently on the show. He was a very well-known guy in the Windows Server team who I think he had been there way over 20 years. He came like many of these big names at Microsoft from Digital Equipment Corp. He worked on Windows Server, Data Center. He did a lot to work on Microsoft proprietary hardware for running the cloud. And another guy from Windows, Bob Kelly, also longtime Windows Server guy. Both of these people have recently left or are about to leave. Two really big names from Microsoft Research. Rick Rashid, who founded Microsoft Research, just retired. Chuck Thacker, he's won like every single award that you can win in the computing field. The Turing Award, the Von Neumann Award. He's like really well known. He's also known as one of the fathers of the tablet PC. He just retired from Microsoft. And probably the most surprising one to me, Dave Campbell, who I know Paul knows too. Yeah. Long time SQL Server guy at Microsoft, very instrumental for SQL Server 7. He became a chief technology officer in Azure at one point, I believe. And he, I think, also recently just left. So all of these people are in the midst of retiring, leaving, moving on. I had somebody ask me, who's replacing them? Pretty much none of these people are replaceable. Like longtime brain trust of Microsoft. Of course, you know, there's new people coming up through the ranks who are the new brain trust, but very significant to me that a lot of these longtime folks are on their way out.
Do you think, I mean, they vested, right? And they're, you know.
Yeah, that would be my guess.
After a while, right. If you're a multi-millionaire, you might wonder, why do you go in 9 to 5?
I know, right.
Yeah, but.
These guys have been there since the 90s.
I know. Yep. These are some of the original people who came from digital.
Yeah, the original NT
digital.
Guys.
Yeah. Started
and I
Windows
see,
NT.
You know, if you're Rick Rashid and you founded Microsoft Research in 1991, and you probably loved it, you know, you've been doing this now for 25 years.
Yeah, but
don't
you imagine?
It's time.
It's like
to
it's like a scene
life.
From Office Space where the two guys are sitting across from you, like, so what is it you do here again? And like, I invented Microsoft Research. Yeah, no, I meant this right. decade. Like, what is it you've been doing?
You know? He's had a great job.
It must be a very strange conversation.
He worked on the mock kernel. I mean, he's had a great life of doing exactly what anybody who gets in the business hopes to do, which is create important stuff and make a ton of money. At some point, if he's been there 25 years, he's got to be in his 50s.
Or older.
Or 60s. And maybe at some point you just go, I'd like to have a little time to sail the world or something.
Well, first of all, I think these guys have plenty of time.
Well, maybe they do.
To say, Joe Belfort just sailed the world.
Right. He's back now, right? He just got back.
Yeah,
he is.
But I mean, you don't have to be that old to, I mean, at Microsoft, you've been around for a while. You get plenty of time off. I mean,
if you're a mailman, you retire after 25 years. If you're in the service, you retire 25 years in the service, you said, you know, you're 45. I'm done, and I have a pension for life. I don't need to stick around.
I know. Some of these people love it. Like, Dave Cutler is still working,
Yeah, because he
I
loves
believe.
What he's doing. That's right. That's right.
Sure. And I feel That's like right. Rick Rashid, probably same thing, and a lot of these guys, same thing. You know, dream job. They get to do whatever they want.
Anecdotally, we know of many other people have also been laid off recently, right, who are not as visible.
Do you think these guys were offered packages? Is that what you're kind of hinting at? Maybe.
Maybe. I don't know that for a fact. Like, but
Rick, we've enjoyed our time together. But you can't keep cooking Chinese food on your hot plate in your office.
I think this is really just part of the whole lean Microsoft thing. They're trying to really focus on people who are contributing to things that are a big deal now, you know?
Yeah. Well, and that's the other thing. Sure, it's a change in company. It's a dramatically changed company, right?
Yeah. This is a very visible example, because you can talk a lot about change. You can come up with cute sayings like mobile first, cloud first, you know. You can kill a couple small projects like Microsoft Band or whatever. But, I mean, I think this is in some ways one of the more, even though it was done quietly, it wasn't like there was a press release, but this is a better indication of how
It's a lot of people.
Yeah.
That is, well, there's something.
How real they're making this change. Yeah. Like, right. This is a real, it's a real change.
It's not just a couple of guys who've been there a long time saying, oh, yeah, it's time. I mean, I'm sure that happens all the time. That's a continual change. If you love your work, I love my work. I could probably retire now, but I don't plan to, because I like what I'm doing. I don't know what I would do with myself.
we all know this. Retirement is not that thing people imagine where you're sitting on the beach drinking something with an umbrella in it.
I mean, I could do that.
You could, but how quickly would that get boring?
Right. Lisa says that. She says you'd be talking into a coconut before too long.
You would arrange fruit in front of you as an audience.
Exactly. Let me tell you my thoughts on the latest Apple phone.
Yep. What's that, Bob? You have a question?
I don't want to be I don't want to be the guy at the bar saying, hey, anybody got any tech questions over here?
Doctor is in.
Although I sometimes have this fantasy, you could do this too. You guys, because Cunard Lines, which do the beautiful, ocean liners, the Queen Mary, they almost always have a tech lecturer on board. And I thought, the people there are hundreds, so I would still be a young guy. I'd be the kid. Oh, they got that kid down and hold in the hold there. He'll help you with your, and then I could be that guy and just live on the boat. That's what I want to do.
Sure.
Any Cunard executives listening?
That would be fun for some number of months, right? I mean, at some point that would get really tedious.
Yeah. No, exactly. So I can see why these guys stayed so long. They've been millionaires for decades, probably.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
And then at the same time,
they pull in their expensive car to their name spot, and they.
You don't want to be. I don't think you want to go out with your boots on, though, do you? You want a little time.
Yeah, I would think. I would think so.
Maybe not. I don't know. We're the wrong people to ask. We actually like our jobs.
I bet all these guys like their jobs too.
And I bet they do too. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm gonna go out like a crying sissy. I can tell you that.
I haven't filed yet. Exactly. I haven't filed.
I'll be the one like holding the door frame as they're trying to push me through.
Yeah. Xbox Schmex Box, says Paul Thurrott.
Leo, I want really. You think I wrote that?
Oh. Is that a Mary Jo? Is that a Foleyism?
It is.
Xbox Schmeckbox.
I gotta say, she's come up with a lot of Xbox content for this week.
But these are her stories?
None of these are my stories, but I was just going through Paul's site when I was doing the show notes, helping with them this morning, and I was like, look at all this Xbox content.
It's like Xbox, well, Xbox, Xbox. All he ever writes about is Xbox.
Well, I set up my son, who's 13, Michael, my stepson.
Yeah.
I got the new 1S, so he said, can I have the 1? I have an Xbox 360 he has in his. Mm-hmm. And I said, yeah, I'll set up the 1. I set that up last night. First thing he wants to do, first thing, the only thing, as far as I can tell, install Call of Duty 1, which is an Xbox 360 game, on the Xbox One. That's Xbox, what he wants to play.
Or Call of Duty, like, classic?
It's an Xbox. Yeah, it's an Xbox 360 game. I don't know what it is. Call of Duty.
Well, Call of Duty 2 came out recently.
Call
of Duty Classic might be on there.
It's the. It's not World at War.
The only Xbox 360 games that are on there are I know Call of Duty 2 and Black Ops 1.
Black Ops 1. That's the one he wanted. It doesn't even say 1 because there wasn't a 2.
It's just Black Ops, right?
It's Black Ops. That's, and so he's playing an Xbox 360 game. Mm. He's got 4 terabytes of storage in his plan.
I will say, I just, since you brought this up, one of the things that's really cool about the old Xbox games showing up on the Xbox One is that in the old days, when you would run these games on an Xbox 360, there's a lot of downloadable content that comes out, you know, map packs and
so
forth.
He asked about his DLC. That's exactly
what it's all there. And what's even better is it just happens through the game hub. You don't have to go into the game and go to the store. Because every game had a slightly different interface for doing it. It just all happens. It's really neat. Yeah. Like, it just happens.
Yeah, it was great.
Yeah, it's really well done.
He's so funny. He says, I need the DLC. I said, okay. He says, do you know what that is? I said,
do you know what that
is? I said, yeah. He said, what does it stand for? He was testing me.
That is what, you know, that's what kids do.
You don't know what it means, do you, Dad? Yes, I do. It means...
So as the adult lion in the scenario, I hope you just hit him right in the face.
Yeah. Said, Simba, get out of here, you knucklehead. No, I just signed him up. He signed up with a Hotmail account. That's how old that...
Yeah, that's what mine is, too. This is the one I'm waiting to get Outlook.com on.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah.
Here comes the first Xbox Play Anywhere title, says Mary Jo Foley, and I know she's excited.
Mary Jo, what's it called again?
She's shaking her head.
Is it called
Cuphead.
Halo.
Nope.
Yeah. When are we getting before. Cuphead, by the way?
We are getting Cuphead this year.
This year?
It was supposed to be by now, wasn't it?
Yeah, but now it's going to be an Xbox Play Anywhere game. It's coming out this fall.
Oh. So what is a Play Anywhere game?
So it's a game where if you buy it digitally on either the Xbox One or Windows 10, you get it on the other platform as well for free. And you don't just get the game for free. It's the same game. So the achievements are all the same. The save games are all the same. So if you progress into the game to a certain place, you can pick it up on the other platform and you just pick it up where you left off. It's the same game, essentially.
That'll be fun. I like that. Yeah, so what's the first one?
So the first one is called ReCore. It's kind of an adventure shooter, or an adventure puzzler shooter, third-person shooter. It's set on a desert planet, you know, in some science fiction future. Mankind was supposed to colonize this thing and everything went wrong. And you run around. You're kind of like a Rey from the new Star Wars movie, a young girl with a robot dog in the beginning. And it's a beautiful game. I've only played the very beginning of it.
I have a review from one of our chatters, A7. Mm-hmm. He says, load times on Xbox One, 2 to 3 minutes. Glitch through the world, respawn in glitched area. It's a mess.
Yeah, it's great. And the nice thing is you get the same experience on both platforms.
Yeah. So when you respawn in a glitch here, you'll respawn in a glitch there. It's a beautiful
game. Right. So actually one of the first things that happened to me, the very first time I played it, very early on, there's a secret. You climb to the top of a mountain. You go into the mountain, and this door slams down, and you have to kind of figure out how to slide through it before it shuts on you.
Yeah.
And the very first time I did it, it shut on me. And instead of killing me, it just captured the character in the door.
So you got stuck in the door.
Yeah. It was unbelievable. And I couldn't figure out how to back out of it.
I hate it when that happens.
Yeah. Yep.
Are you getting stuck in walls, doors? It's just that's awful.
It's like adding to the insult. You're like, you know, you're going up and down in the door as it animates. And it's like
A7 said, "Yep, happened to me too."
Yep.
Well, that's one to try for.
Yeah. Unfortunately, there's no achievement for that. So this other one's got Forza Horizon game is coming soon. The Gears of War 4 is going to be one.
I think Cuphead might be my first one. I'm not too excited about either of those.
Well, I mean, they're all made by different companies. Not like it's the the Play Anywhere platform that's causing the problems. It's just it's too bad. So, in other Xbox news, there's some new as Mary Jo notes here in the notes, this new Xbox One S bundle's coming. Let me see. Let's bring it up here real quick. These are kind of cool because they're just colors. So in other words, instead of having like a console where they really like, you know, change the look and feel like there's a Gears of War one with these huge scratch marks in it and stuff, two of the three new Battlefield 1 bundles are just colors. So there's like a storm gray version, which is kind of a nice gray color. And then there's a kind of a military green version as well. So the console and the controller are both these colors. And so those are kind of cool. Those are all for Battlefield 1, so they come with the game. There's some new controllers that have kind of cool, colorful designs. There's a new version of the Xbox over-the-ear headset. And there's actually a black version of the controller, which sounds a little weird because the Xbox One controller for the past couple of years has just been black. But the Xbox One S version of the controller, which is now just called the Xbox Wireless controller, has some additional features over the original controller, like the grippy back, the better sticks, and Bluetooth capability, so you can use it with Windows directly without an adapter. So this is a new version of that. Well, I should say this is a black version of that, if you will. So anyone who's, you know, wanted the black controller will be able to get that soon. So that stuff is all happening, I think, by the end of October. Some of it's in September, some of it's in October. And then the Halo 5 one, you know, this is kind of interesting to me because I'm not really a big Halo fan. In the early days of the original Xbox, I was. I played through the original Halo possibly a dozen times. Halo 2, several times, absolutely. Halo 3, even, I played through at least a couple of times. I remember doing it on different difficulty levels. Really enjoyed those games a lot. Did a lot of the multiplayer stuff. But it's kind of lost me over the years. You know, I think for me, Call of Duty is just a much better multiplayer experience. But I have to give these guys a lot of credit because, you know, Halo 5 came out as an Xbox One exclusive. Since then, they have released over and over again free DLC. Leo, do you know what that means, DLC, by the way?
Destroy Leo's computer. I think that's what Michael thinks it means anyway, yeah.
So they've had like 9 major DLC drops on Halo 5, and they've all been free. And so the latest is called Anvil's Legacy, and this one's a big deal on a number of levels, but the big news really is that the Forge toolset, which is the application you can run on the Xbox usually to make levels for Halo, now works on Windows 10 PCs. And that means you can use it with a mouse. That means you can use it on a 4K display and really you know, get in there and see the elements very close up. And you can build levels for Halo 5 on a PC now using this free tool.
That's pretty Halo cool. 5. That's
pretty, yeah, it is pretty cool. Again, I'm not going to do it myself, and I'm not really into Halo, but I have to say, you know, as someone who pays a lot of money, in fact, you will always pay as much for DLC on a Call of Duty game as you do for the game itself if you buy the, you know, the year pass. It's incredible that this game would be supported this way. Like, that's really neat. So good for them.
It's foolish to ask, but do you have an opinion on the Sony PlayStation announcements?
Yeah, I do. You know, I said something earlier about me being like a reaction nerve or whatever. I go through stages with this kind of stuff. And so we knew Sony was coming out with a low-cost version of the PlayStation 4, like the Xbox One S.
Right.
And we knew that Sony was coming out with a 4K version of the console. The big difference between what Microsoft is doing and what Sony is doing, the biggest difference, is that both of those consoles are happening this year, whereas Microsoft's 4K console isn't happening until next year. Sony has been outselling Microsoft 2-1 this generation of consoles. I don't see that changing. And I think that I've always thought that this notion of mid-life cycle platform upgrades is super smart. And I'm really glad to see both of the big companies are doing this. The ability to play all of the existing games and have them potentially be even better on the higher-end console is a nice upgrade path for people. I think the biggest problem with consoles to date has always been that you basically lose the old games when you go to the new. And that's, you know, true of consoles in the 1980s, like when you went from a 2600 to a 5200, or modern consoles like the Xbox 360 to Xbox One, or the PlayStation to whatever. You know, this has always been an issue. And they sort of figured out ways around it. You know, we have the backwards compatibility thing now for Xbox One. And it's neat. Like, I'm really glad it's there. But The truth is, these are two completely different platforms. And that Xbox 360 game your son's playing, Black Ops, on the Xbox One, that's basically a Centennial app running on, you know, it's that kind of technology. It's a self-contained virtual machine kind of thing. It's like it's emulation, essentially. And not having to do that, you know, is important. These games are expensive. We just, you know, DLC is $60 a year for Call of Duty. The game is $60. It's really neat for that stuff to go forward onto a console that can not only just play those things and play them properly, but also play better-looking games. 4K, perhaps, in the case of Sony, or virtual reality stuff that might look better on the higher-end console. So I think the big thing for Sony is that they're doing it now. And I think we all understand these games are not going to run at 4K resolutions pretty much ever, or it, you know, or certainly not all the time. But I think anything over 1080p, if you're a console guy, that's a big, it's a big deal. And there's a new Call of Duty game coming out this fall. There's a new Call of Duty remastered Modern Warfare that comes with it for free. Those will look better on the PlayStation Pro. And that really makes me want to own one of those because that's a big deal for me. So yeah, we'll see what Microsoft does next year. But I don't know. I think they're going to, I think Xbox is going to have a few months in the sun where they kind of outsell PlayStation. And then I think it's over. You know, and that's the way it's been for most of this generation. So,
Interesting. That would be a big change.
Yeah, Microsoft and Sony are doing very, very similar things, but there are some key differences. And I think, you know, we'll have to see. We don't really know how Microsoft's going to handle VR and things like that. So we have to kind of wait and see. But the Sony's stuff being here now is a big deal.
Although, you know, people are complaining a little bit that it's upscaled 4K. There's, you know, they didn't put Microsoft has the win with the player, right?
Look, I bought a couple of, you mean like the disc player?
Sony didn't put its own Blu-ray UHD player in the PlayStation 4.
The mistake Sony had made at the beginning of the PC generation was Blu-ray was super, super expensive. And that kind of made the console super expensive compared to the Xbox. So the Xbox got off to an early lead that time. You know, this generation, Microsoft has Blu-ray UHD, and it's, you know, I play like the Revenant or that Mad Max movie.
But you have to have a TV that
incredible,
supports it.
So incredible experience.
Might not be that important, I guess, maybe.
Well, they're disc-based, but see, that's the problem. I think one of the things I've done with this generation is I never buy games on disc. I buy everything electronically
or
digitally.
Yeah, who wants to download? I mean,
Sony is going to have a bunch of 4K digital content that's not disc. That might ultimately prove to be an advantage.
It does kind of make sense. In some ways, a physical media is a little retro.
Yeah.
If it adds to the price, we've learned how price-sensitive this market is. I mean, I think that's where Xbox got bit.
Yeah,
Xbox One got bit.
If you're really into movies and you have this incredible sound system and home theater system, the ability to play 4K Blu-rays on an Xbox One S is a big deal. And even just for those kinds of players, I think the Xbox is competitive. Like, I think it's a pretty inexpensive way to get it done.
Yeah, somebody just pointed out in the chat room, the Xbox One has sold as many units as the Apple Watch. So
that's so it's a disaster.
Let's take a break. And the back of the book coming up, your tips, your tricks, your magic code names, and all of that. But first, a word from this superior product. I love our Ring video doorbell. We have one at home. I installed it. I am not the most handiest of fellas, but I had no trouble installing this. I just unscrewed the old wired doorbell and put the Ring in its place. And it took me, I don't know, I'm not, they say you could do it in a half an hour. I probably could this time around. First time maybe took me an hour because I read everything and I watched the videos they have online and stuff. The kit comes with the doorbell, but even like a drill bit, if you needed to, I didn't need to do any drilling. The hole was already there. The two wires coming out of the door jamb. It does come with a screwdriver handle and the two bits you need, including this special proprietary bit that you use to attach the doorbell so that it's, you know, not easily removable if somebody should come along. You have the key, but they don't. Also a level, which is really sweet. And you might wonder, well, what's this? This USB charger cable. Well, the original Ring has a lithium-ion battery, so it doesn't have to be on a wired doorbell. There's a new Ring, the Ring Pro, that's designed for wired doorbells that has a 1080p instead of 720p camera. But both Rings have high-def, wide-angle camera, motion sensors. They, of course, have a doorbell that rings when you push it, and it rings in your house. If it's wired, it's just like the original doorbell, although a little less ratty than mine. They have finishes that match all the different houses and so forth. And it's connected to your Wi-Fi. And that's where things really start to get interesting, because when somebody rings your doorbell or even comes up your steps, because the motion sensor will trigger it on your phone. So I've paired it to my Mac, to my iPhone, to my Android phone. It does Windows, too. And then when the doorbell rings or you get a notification, hey, somebody's out front, you can press a button and talk to them. and see them. And they hear you. There's a speaker on it and a microphone, and you can hear them. So if it's a bad guy or suspicious individual, you can chase them away. If it's the UPS guy, you could say, hey, leave the package there. I'll be right out. You can keep an eye on that package. It really is awesome. If you go to ring.com/WW right now, you can get as much as $150 off what they're calling their Ring of Security kits. They put together a bunch of bundles of different Ring products. So they not only have the doorbells, that's how they started. Let me go there right now and show you the website. But they have the stick-up cam, which is basically a Ring without the doorbell. So it's the camera, the motion sensors, the speaker, the microphone, and, of course, Wi-Fi. And so with that, you can monitor any area that you can't see from the front door. You can speak to people. I think this is so cool. Who are at your, you know, in the backyard or coming over a fence. We have a neighbor who's been coming over our fence. And so, absolutely, I got that. I told him, I said, I have a camera. And the next time he comes over, I'm saying, hey, Bob, I see you. I can't wait to, I'll record that one. Yeah, by the way, offline recording, you can go back in time and check it. It's very affordable if you want to subscribe to that, so you don't have to store it. There is a bunch of other Ring products, not just the stick-up cam, but the solar panel to charge it, keep it charged. The Ring chime, so you can put a doorbell, a ding-donger part of the doorbell anywhere, including, you know, back places or workspaces that you can't hear the main doorbell. And I love this, too. You get the solar security sign in any one of these bundles, which is a, you know, these things really work to scare away burglars to have this sign there. And this one lights up because it's got a little solar panel on it. All of that can be yours with the Ring or Ring Pro kits. Go to ring.com/WW. If you don't yet have a Ring doorbell, get one. And think about it for your family members, too, like older parents, that kind of thing. Anybody who just wants to keep an eye on what's going on outside their house. Ring.com/WW. I can't tell you what a convenience it is. I know exactly who's coming and going. We have the electrician there right now doing some wiring for us, and I'll know when he's done. So I have, you know, kind of an exact record of when he was there. I love it. Ring.com/WW. Paul Thurrott, Mary Jo Foley. We're talking Windows on Windows Weekly. And let's kick things off with the tip of the week, Paul.
So we don't have an audible pick, but this is kind of an audible tip.
That's good. I'll take it.
Yeah. Back earlier this year, Audible launched something called Channels, which is kind of a short, well, it's not really that short, but short compared to audiobook, short format, original programming, and exclusive content. They also have podcasts in there. I think it's about, I can't remember the exact price if you have to pay for it. If you're not an Audible member, like a Gold member or higher, you have to pay, I want to say $5 a month, maybe $50, $60 a year. But now it's also available for free to Amazon Prime members. And since so many people are probably members of Amazon Prime, this is something you might want to look at. It's pretty cool. I haven't done too much to this. I've followed a bunch of playlists. There's some pretty cool ones in there. And the problem is when I'm out walking around and traveling, I tend to listen to audiobooks or, you know, podcasts or whatever. So I haven't really done a lot with
this. It's nice to have this, though, because it's like streaming content that you can get right away if you don't have a book you're listening to.
Yeah, and it's also... it also kind of speaks to, my sort of evolving way of using Audible, which is that rather than listen to these gigantic 47-hour-long books, like I kind of prefer short stories to the longer stories because it's just hard for me to, you know, kind of keep track of what's going on in the longer things. And this stuff falls into that kind of low attention span theater type area. So anyway, it's nice. Something to check out. If you're an Audible user, check it out. If you're not and you're a Prime user, go check it out because it's free now. So
cool.
Pretty cool. And then the app pick of the week is Twitter is launching today on Xbox One and also on Apple TV and Amazon Fire TV. You know, my initial reaction to that is like, okay, Twitter, like what am I going to watch? Like a text, you know, scroll up on my TV. But actually, there's a lot of video content on Twitter, and this is about that kind of content. I'm sure you can still look at text if you want to. But Amazon is doing live streaming of NFL games this fall on Thursday nights. Not, I don't think every single one, but at least 10 or 12 of them. And they have deals with the Major League Baseball, with the NBA. There's going to be all kinds of video content going through Twitter, and the app's free. You don't have to have a Twitter account. You can just open the app and start looking at content. So That's something to check out. And this happened almost a week ago, but I think we did the show early last week, right? Yeah, because of the Apple event. So last week, Microsoft updated its Arrow Launcher, which is a home app replacement for Android. They've actually released a bunch of big updates to this app this year. The biggest one happened in August when they gave you the chance to replace the apps screen, which normally in this launcher orders your apps by usage so that your most used apps are at the top, which, you know, is neat for some people. But some people want to be able to just arrange things the way they want them, like you would normally in Android. So they added that capability. This update adds a high performance mode, which will speed things up for people who are seeing slowness due to the animations that the app has. There's a Bing search functionality that's been added into it. I was kind of surprised that wasn't there already. And they've added instant messenger support to recent. And I have to, I'll be right back. But I'm done. So Mary Jo.
Okay. Mary Jo Foley while Paul goes to the bathroom or something. I don't know what's going on. Probably the UPS guy delivering his new game.
Yeah, probably.
Yeah. Enterprise pick of the week.
So the enterprise pick of the week is something called Service Fabric for Linux. Service Fabric is Microsoft's name for its microservices platform. It's basically Azure Platform as a Service 2.0. And Microsoft already has Service Fabric available for Windows Server. They announced, I think it was at Build, that they were doing a very limited preview of Service Fabric on Linux on Azure. And as of September 26, which is the opening day of Microsoft's Ignite conference, they're going to have a broad preview of Service Fabric for Linux on Azure available to anyone who wants to test it. So what Service Fabric lets you do is it lets you build and deploy applications in the form of microservices. You know, so they're discrete components that are independent of each other and independent of the underlying infrastructure. It's kind of like the wave of the future if you're doing cloud apps. And it's very interesting they're doing this on Linux too and not just on Windows Server, but it kind of makes sense because, as we know, 1 in 3 virtual machines on Azure right now are running Linux and not Windows Server. So yeah, watch on the 26th if you want to kick the tires of Service Fabric for Linux on Azure. That's the enterprise pick.
Okay. Codename pick?
Codename is a codename I've made a pick before. It's called Project Madeira. And I remember we couldn't really figure out why Microsoft was using Madeira as the codename. But the reason it's back in the news this week is there was a little leak of all the pricing and licensing information for Microsoft Dynamics 365 overnight. There was a Microsoft partner that posted this, didn't realize it was NDA. Microsoft hasn't even launched Dynamics 365 yet, but now we know the pricing and licensing basically for it. And the first piece of Dynamics 365, which is Microsoft's Dynamics ERP and CRM platform brought to Azure, is going to be this thing called Madeira. Madeira is the financials piece of the equation that's available as software as a service. And we were all wondering how much they would charge for that. And it turns out $40 per user per month is the price, it looks like, if you buy that as a standalone thing. You can also buy it as part of a package, a whole bundle with other things besides financials, like sales and marketing and other things. So I would say if you're interested in looking at the pricing on Dynamics 365, I've got a very in-depth post on my site based on the leaked information with all the packages and the plans and the prices. It's pretty expensive, I have to say. I was wondering where they would come in on the pricing. But yeah, some of these plans, they're very feature-rich. They include a lot of modules, but you're not going to get it cheap. If you're a smaller, like small to mid-sized business, the cheapest kinds of plans you're looking at are basically in the $100 plus per user per month range. So yeah, not for the faint of heart, but that you do get a lot of functionality. I'm very interested to see how Microsoft's going to roll out Dynamics 365. I think we're going to see kind of an official launch of this in early, like the first or second week of October. And yeah, going to be interesting how they go up against people like Oracle and some of the other financials as a service vendors in the space.
Cool. Have some Madeira.
Madeira.
I know. Yeah. I don't know why they called it Madeira. Interesting code name.
And Paul's back just in time for the beer pick of the week.
Well, he might want to miss this one because it's a double IPA.
All right, Paul, forget it.
I appreciate the consistency.
All right, but there's some interesting things about my pick today. So it's from a brewery I've never talked about before in the Pittsburgh area called Brew Gentleman. That's the name of the brewery. And they are very, very kind of unsung hero in the craft beer world. So if you're ever in the Pittsburgh area, try to find their beers. The beer that I picked from them is something called Lou. And Lou is a beer that's in the service called Ales for ALS. ALS is Lou Gehrig's disease.
Oh, this is neat.
Yeah, so every year there are a whole bunch of brewers all over the U.S. who get a special hop blend from the participating, hop growers. They are all given the same hop blend. They all create a different beer from it. And then they give a portion of the proceeds from that beer back to the ALS research organization. So this one, Brew Gentleman's Lou, is one of these ales for ales. And I just got to have some recently from a friend who brought it to me. And I have to say, these guys know how to make beer. It's really nice to be able to contribute to the Lou Gehrig Foundation, or whoever the group is that's fighting Lou Gehrig's disease, through drinking beer. So look for your ales for owls. There are a lot of different owls. Brewers do them. Yeah.
I think that's a great idea.
Yeah, it's really cool.
And who cares if it's hoppy? I like hops.
Yeah, you know what's funny? Double IPAs, even though, despite the name, I bet Paul would actually like them more than single IPAs because they're way more balanced typically with malt and hops.
Okay. So the brewery near me that I like so much, and I think you've had this, it's called Quarter Mile. They make a fantastic double IPA.
Oh, there you go. There you go.
Yeah.
There you go.
So quick mention on two events. Can we do a quick one?
Yeah, you've got some stuff coming up.
Yeah,
we do. Microsoft Ignite, we're doing Windows Weekly Live September 28th, which is Wednesday at our usual time, 2 p.m. at the show. It's in this area called Connector something. I can't remember the name of it, but we're going to be, I guess, in the show guide, or somehow they're going to promote where our event is. And we're going to be taping the show live there. We may have special guests, who knows? If you're watching remotely, you'll just see us doing the show, but from Atlanta live. And then we're going to do a meetup probably right after that. I'm having a little trouble nailing down a place for us because Ignite is a gigantic show with 20,000 plus people.
It sucks and I've the been life calling out of around. The whole city.
It kind of does. Yeah. So we're still working on a meetup spot. Stay tuned. And if anybody who's listening knows of a place we might hold a meetup for Windows Weekly, send us some mail and we can look into it.
We're not averse to backyard barbecues.
So. That would be fun.
That would be really fun.
Yeah, I like that idea.
That'd be cool.
Yeah.
And Vegas. We're going to Vegas. Intersection, IT Intersection is the name of the show. If you want to look it up, devintersection.com. We're going to be there the last week of October. There are a lot of really good speakers at this event. I think Scott Guthrie and Brad Anderson and Scott Hanselman. It's a pretty big deal, pretty big lineup. And Paul us. And I, too. And us. We're going to be there, too, speaking. And hopefully doing Windows Weekly Live from there. And maybe that will be the day of the hardware launch. And if it is, we'll figure something out to cover it from Las Vegas. We'll see.
All right. Look forward to that as well. Gosh, I'd love to go.
You should come. Why not?
I have other things, too.
I can promise you sushi.
Las Vegas.
You know, I always thought that the best sushi would come from somewhere really inland, maybe even in the desert.
Leo.
Because there's no better
fish.
You know
that sushi is flash frozen.
Than desert fish.
Doesn't matter. I've had really good sushi in
Vegas. I know. Everything in Vegas is good. They have airplanes now. They can fly the stuff in.
Yeah.
Paul Thurrott is always available on his website, Thurrott.com. I'm now
perhaps a little too available.
Well, no, I paid a lot of money, $42 for premium access, so I get Paul anytime I want him.
Yeah, when should I show up with the balloons at your kid's birthday party?
I think I have his cell phone number. Go to thurrott.com for that. It's great. And it's not just Paul, of course, it's Brad Sams and lots of other great people. And then don't forget Paul's books, which are available at leanpub.com, including the Field Guide to Windows 10, which is at this point kind of a must-have. Mary Jo Foley blogs regularly at allaboutmicrosoft.com, her ZDNet blog. And if you make friends with her, you might even be able to visit her home and eat some beer, drink some beer. Because, yeah, 42.
You mean Rattle and Hum, my home?
Rattle and Hum, that's what I meant. Yeah, where she lives, Rattle and Hum. Yeah. Hey, anybody who's got a mug with their name on it at a bar, yeah, I think you qualify. Yeah.
You're either the mayor of Boston or you own the place.
Yeah, right. And we do Windows Weekly Wednesdays, 11 a.m. Pacific, 2 p.m. Eastern, 1800 UTC. I won't be here next Wednesday because it's going to be Father Robert. Actually, I'm going to miss about three shows. Be back.
Yeah, but you're going to do something awesome.
I'm really looking forward to it. I get vacation.
Are you bringing electronics?
Yeah, what's going on there?
Yeah, I thought you might ask me about that. So
you don't have to tell us.
It went from not bringing any electronics to bringing all the electronics.
Oh, no.
Basically.
You're bringing your own Xbox for the cruise.
Yeah, I should.
It's like people used to travel in the 1920s. You got these big steamer trunks
just for the electronics.
Elephant caravan.
Yeah. I thought it seemed like a good idea at the time, and then I realized, well, there's going to be a new iPhone. I need to try that out. And then, you know, Andy Inako convinced me to get this new Yee action cam. And so I bought a selfie stick. And, Well, it's just all gone downhill from there. I have more electronics than I could shake a selfie stick at. So sorry, Mary Jo. It was a good idea.
You're not bringing a selfie stick, are you? Tell me no.
No.
Okay.
That was the smart answer, Leo.
That was the correct answer.
Well, I have this idea
mm-hmm.
of doing a selfie portrait everywhere with me and Lisa. Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's cute.
Yeah. Just one. I'm not going to do a lot of them. But just okay.
Why don't you just let someone else take the picture?
Oh, but then it wouldn't be a selfie. It'd be a themsie. Selfie. No, I don't know. I was reading on Instagram. There's a travel blogger, an attractive young lady, who her hand is missing in every picture, and I realize it's because she's holding a selfie stick, and but she's smart. She doesn't look at the camera. She's always looking away, but she's always got an arm going straight behind her, and actually it's kind of cool because you get the scene mm-hmm. setting, and then you get a person, and that's kind of neat. I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Okay.
I could live stream from the cabin. That's how bad it is. Although
we tried to help you.
I have been informed by somebody who was on the very boat we're going to be on not so long ago that the Wi-Fi is virtually unusable on the boat.
Oh.
And in fact, they're dry docking it right after our trip to fix it. So,
yikes.
So in a way, it'll be a kind of a self-enforced low-tech voyage.
That's true.
So that's
okay.
Yeah. I'm happy about that. I'm bringing books and stuff. I'm mostly going to read. Yeah.
Well, listen, what you're doing is awesome. It's going to be so great.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I can't wait. I'm really excited. Seeing 10 countries.
I'm kind of looking forward to it just to see the pictures.
Yeah,
you know?
10 countries mm-hmm. in 12 days, something like that.
Yeah. That's going to be cool.
It's cool.
Yeah.
but I'll head to Paris for me, Leo.
I can't wait. Yeah. Mm-hmm. We're having dinner in the Eiffel Tower.
Mm, which one?
Jules Verne. It's yep. a. Yeah, I can't wait. You know it. Paul knows Paris.
I've been there twice.
Have you? You've been to Jules Verne?
Yeah.
Really?
Yep.
How fun. It's you like it?
It's amazing.
It's a Paul Ducasse restaurant, right? It's a Michelin one star,
I
think.
Sure, it is a Michelin star restaurant. Yeah, it's really good.
But
it's probably the best food experience I've ever had.
Okay, that sounds pretty good. I'll take it.
There's another restaurant in the Eiffel Tower now.
There's like a less expensive kind
it's
of
not, It's not touristy. Even close.
Yeah,
it's pretty good, but it's not.
No, we wanted to do the fancy one.
Yep. No, that's amazing.
Is
that's
there a hotel there? I think somebody told me you could spend the night. Maybe it's just if you pass out.
No, I got this kiosk. I got my bottle. That sounds right. But, you know, the problem with the Eiffel Tower is that you can't see the Eiffel Tower.
That's, you know, where am I? What city am I in? It just looks like a lot of buildings.
I mean, that's kind of the most iconic thing to see in Paris.
It is true, isn't it? Yeah. Now, we're staying on the left bank, and it's going to be fun. I'm looking forward
to it. Awesome. I'm looking forward to seeing this.
We jet to Stockholm, from there to Helsinki by boat.
You're doing dinner or lunch at...
Dinner.
Jules Verne, yeah. Okay.
It's the weirdest thing. You have to, you buy it ahead of time, and then you get it. That gives you a number, and the number allows you to call for a reservation.
So
it's very the French. Best,
the best part about this, though, is you get to go up in your own column of the Eiffel Tower in an elevator all by yourself.
It's a special elevator.
And then you get to go all the way to the top from there.
You
from
do?
From the restaurant.
Oh, that's what I was wondering. Oh, yeah, because the lines for the Eiffel Tower are murder.
Yeah, there's no lines. There'll be no line for you. Yeah, it's really neat.
Good.
Yeah.
Yeah. Once a year, I like to have a really great vacation if I can. And
so that's that sounds good.
But I shall return after my Le Royale with cheese. thank you, Mary Jo. Thank you, Paul. Thank you all for joining us. And we will be back here next week. I think it's Father Robert, right? Going to be hosting the show at its usual time. See y'all.
We'll
see y'all in 3 weeks. Bye bye. Take care, guys.